Welcome back. We got a little sub video today, and we're going to be cooking up an amazing story called The Sound of Silence, and not the song by Simon and Garfunkel like you were just thinking. I swear you were. So let's go ahead and get into it. Let's say you want to access the sub work. You just go to the Schoology there. You find your core one, your core two, your core three. Let's just say, for example, you are core one. Then you would go here to sub work for today, try to make it clear as can be, and boom, you would click on this here. And then that, what shows up here, you would of course click happy, right? But here I already clicked happy and boom, this shows up, like I promised, The Sound of Silence. This book is fire. All right, so we are going to get into it today. Let's go ahead and start rolling. Uh-oh, does somebody not have their Chromebook? Is somebody's Chromebook broken? Well, guess what? In the back of the room or the front of the room, there's a bunch of extra loose leaf paper. You can also use your binder, which is labeled up front. So you need to make sure that you have paper now. Take a moment, especially if you don't have a computer, to make sure you have some loose leaf. Go ahead and do that now. Hopefully you got all that paper. So what you can do for those of you who do have a computer is right here. You can just go ahead and put your initials. My first name is Mr. And my last name is Surface. That was a little better than the end, wasn't it? All right. So the essential question is, how does society influence identity and experience? Well, you're going to switch it over to the highlighter and you're going to click that mustard yellow. So what are some words that are important in that essential question? Society, influence, identity, experience. Do you see anything below that connects with that? I do. I see Yoshio, right? That's going to have something to do with an individual identity. I see Tokyo. Big cities always have plenty of society. So we've got our society, we've got our identity, and I've got the experience of sound and the experience of children, of being young, and the experience of being young and listening to silence. Or what silence actually consists of, which is the subject of this book. Those of you without a computer, I'd like you to take a look at this word cloud now. And on your paper, you're going to write down some of the things that you saw. For instance, you might write down silence, sound, children. All right, there's plenty more for you to look at. Go ahead and take a look at that word cloud now. The substitute can pause it for the next 30 seconds or so. All right. So, silent sound children, you should have more than that now. So let's take a look at this prompt. And those of you with paper, you can go ahead and just write down the two most important words. But let's take a look at the prompt together first. Sensory language, words that activate the senses, play an essential role in great books. Analyze the role of the senses in the sounds of silence. Reference the text. So what are the two most important words in that text-dependent analysis prompt? Take a moment and find those two most important words, please. Perhaps you went with sensory language. That would have been a perfect choice. Maybe you went with senses. Or perhaps it's analyzed the role of the senses. So role and senses comes twice. All right? So the sound of silence. One thing we are looking for when we keep talking about this attention to sound and smell and sight and touch and taste is we're talking about imagery. Let's annotate this real quick. The use of words and phrases that appeal to one or more of the senses. And we've got sight and hearing. Well, I know hearing is emphasized in this story, just like it's emphasized in the prompt up here. Analyze the role of the sense as well. It's called the sound of silence. I'm going to put sounds there and hearing there. What does the author see or hear? Sensory detail. Well, I know that's important. I'm going to put my light bulb on top of sensory detail. Is the author describing something they smell, they can feel via touch or taste? That seems to connect right with what we're focused on imagery today. I'm going to go next to hearing again. My question is, what kind of shows or books might involve taste a little more than we're used to? Just something to think on today. So we're going to watch a little clip together. And during this clip, we're going to take some notes about things that we notice. Things that we notice about the sound in it. And things that we might wonder. So what can we do to do that? Well, we got to make some lines. We're going to make these a little bit thicker. I'm going to put one line across just like that. And put one line down just through the middle like that. And then on this side, on the left, I'm going to switch it to text. And I'm going to write one thing I notice. And over here, I'm going to write one thing that I wonder about. Okay. So we're going to go back and forth, but let's watch this. This is a small clip from the 2005 movie War of the Worlds, a remake of the H.G. Wells. Let's take a listen. Let's take a look. So already we hear chatter and sizzling. So I notice chatter and sizzling. I notice people saying, back up. But they're like in the back. They draw your attention to the sense of touch, right? Touch. It's freezing. You might be wondering, why is it freezing if it is from lightning? Again, you have these questions. Hear that? Bringing your senses in. Feel that? Bringing your senses in. Putting the reader in the story. The watcher.
There's nothing else down there.
The water main doesn't run through here. You feel that?
Well, there's something down there and it's moving.
Shattering glass and screaming start, right? So that's what I'm noticing. Shattering glass, screaming, people screaming, move. Thank you. then we have our sense of touch, right? Sort of dancing across the fissure. And I'm going to put a comma and I'm going to put touch again, trying to put the reader in that place. Spray of water in the sun. What an image, right? You've got to get that going. So I would put the water, sunlight, spray. By the way, notice how the sound builds and builds, right? It just goes up and up, the sound. This is of the spacecraft. Some people call it a tripod. And then finally the music begins and then it starts murking everybody. So, and then finally music sets in, right? You might wonder, what is the sound, right? Here comes that quiet again. And and that sort of loud, weird, alien-sounding foghorn, right? I'm running out of room on my thing, so I might put it off to the side here. I might go foghorn. And I might wonder, like, what is the sound for? Like, why the horn? All right? Those are some of my notes based on the imagery in that clip. Now, next, think about imagery again. Sight, hearing, smell, touch, and taste. And I want to show you another clip that really draws your attention to the senses, right? All of them. Almost all of them get activated. This next clip is crazy. It comes from a movie Kung Fu Hustle. And basically the premise is this gang is trying to take over this neighborhood and the neighborhood is fighting back. And the neighborhood's pretty good at fighting. So they send in these special assassins who use this sort of instrument of death to get rid of the kung fu heroes of the town. So take a look, take a listen, and pay attention to imagery in this clip from Kung Fu Hustle. Already, you notice there's a ton of stuff going on. So, on that next slide, you can go ahead and make another T-chart. Right? Eat. Eat. And you know, once again, on the left side, it is things that you notice. On the other side, things that you wonder. And I'm already wondering, like, what's that? Why the reverb? Why is there so much, like, why does it sound like they're fighting in a cave all of a sudden? Is it because of the speed at which they're fighting? Right? Things that I noticed, the tearing sound. Getting me set. No music. Preparing me there. All right, let's see what else. Notice the attention to sound here is so on point, is so sophisticated, right? We have the sound of the rings. We have the sound of the sleeves. We have the sound of the glass breaking. And we have the sound of the yard that they're kind of going out into. I think more accurately would be courtyard. Right, and now we have this really close attention being played to music, right? So the role of music becomes foregrounded. Music is put in the foreground, right? And it's just this very austere sound of this thing called a koto, is what that's called.
Thank you.
And then you can hear the sort of spring of that thing, right? The spring sound. Alright, what I'd like you to do is for the rest of this clip is to write at least 5 items that you notice. They can be things that you wonder or notice, but it needs to be a total of 5. And please put those in the color red. Please write your other, ooh, whoopsie daisy. Please write the new stuff in the color red, which means you might have to click on the side there and make a new one over here to the thing. And then you can start to write whatever. Then you can start to write whatever it is. There we go. You notice or whatever it is that you wonder. That's where it ends. Take a moment now, please. And I'd like you to, And I'd like you to pretty please take a moment and write 5 things that you wonder and notice about that last clip. Take the time to do that now. The substitute can pause the video. All right. So, we are going to read a story called The Sound of Silence, like I said. And while you read and while you think about the last 2 clips and the story itself, you're thinking about this vocab word texture. Drag the blue over there to that word texture. Texture can mean, if you're using just simple synonyms, it can mean the feel, the touch, appearance, the finish, surface, grain, or quality. I like the grain, right? Because texture can go to sound, and sometimes you can describe in a very granular, right, relating to grain, a very granular way how something sounds. So I don't want to skip on sound. Obviously, sound is very important in this. I'm wondering why that umbrella's been abandoned. And otherwise, I don't see any other sensory language besides the word silence. Instead of me reading the story, I'm going to have someone else do it.
The Sound of Silence by Katrina Goldsaito, illustrated by Julia Kuo. Little Yoshio wiggled with anticipation. 3, 2, 1. He threw open the front door. The sounds of the city swirled all around him. Tokyo was like a symphony hall. Yoshio listened to the sound of his boots squishing and squashing through the puddles, and the tiny raindrops pattering on his umbrella. The sound of his giddy giggles made him giggle more. Suddenly, Yoshio heard the strangest sound, high and then low, squeaky and vibrating, amazing. It was a koto player carefully tuning her instrument. Then the koto player played. The notes were twangy and twinkling. They tickled Yoshio's ears. When the song finished, Yoshio said, "Sensei, I love sounds, but I've never heard a sound like that." The koto player laughed, and it sounded like the metal bell that swayed in the wind in Mama's garden. "Sensei," Yoshio said, "do you have a favorite sound?" "The most beautiful sound," the koto player said, "is the sound of ma, of silence." "Silence?" Yoshio asked. But the koto player just smiled a mysterious smile and went back to playing. Yoshio bowed to the koto player and ran to school. "Where can I find silence?" Yoshio wondered as he listened to the thwack of his boots on the pavement. He listened for it through the school day, but there was always some kid making noise. At recess, the sun came out and Yoshio went to the quietest place he knew, the bamboo grove at the edge of the playground. But even there, the bamboo made a take 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 sound as the wind banged its stalks together. He closed his eyes and heard the swish, swish, swish of the wind, making the leaves talk. It was beautiful, but it wasn't silence. Walking home from school, Yoshio listened hard. He could hear the horns of buses and the whoosh of bullet trains and the beep, beep, beep of the traffic lights, but no silence. Yoshio knew so many different sounds, loud and soft, sudden and soothing, but silence? Where was silence? It wasn't in the dining room where there was always the sound of chopsticks and slurping and chewing and swallowing. What a noisy family. Silence wasn't in the bath where even his toes made noise and little droplets of water kept dripping off his nose. Drip, drip, drip. That night, Yoshio tried to stay up late to catch the silence while his family slept, but his eyes got heavy and then heavier, and soon the sound of a distant radio became part of his dreams. The next morning, Yoshio woke up to his neighbor's dog barking and barking, and oh no, he had missed the silence. Yoshio walked to school early. His sisters whizzed by on their way to the park, screeching Yoshio's name. Where was silence? Yoshio heard the creak of the school gates as he pulled them open. No one was at school yet. He put on his inside shoes and listened as they shuffled on the shiny floor. The classroom felt different without anyone in it. He sat at his desk by the window and pulled out a book. He loved this story, and as he read, he forgot where he was. Suddenly, in the middle of a page, he heard it. No sounds of footsteps, no people chattering, no radios, no bamboo, no kotos being tuned. In that short moment, Yoshio couldn't even hear the sound of his own breath. Everything felt still inside him. Peaceful, like the garden after it snowed, like feather-stuffed futons drying in the sun. Silence had been there all along. It had been there between the thumps of his boots when he ran, when the wind stopped for just a moment in the bamboo grove, at the end of his family's meal when everyone was happy and full, after the water finished draining from his bath, before the koto player's music began, and hovering in the air right after it ended. It was between and underneath every sound, and it had been there all along. Ma, silence.
And thus ends the story. So we have a few things that we're going to get at. Now, we're going to get out a few ideas here. We're going to try a few new things, and we're going to get the pencil. We're going to increase its size and go with black. And your job for each of these next couple of pictures is to figure out what are three interesting images that you like to preserve. So you want to take a moment to look at the picture. Me, I'm noticing that bright red cap. I'm noticing the cat that wants to go outside. And I'm also noticing how interesting the door frame is. So what I'm going to do is get one little part of that too. So let me get the hat first. Maybe I'll shrink that around and just circle it. I'm going to keep the hat. I'm going to keep the cat. And I'm going to keep these boots. I think those are the three details. The rest, then you've got to turn it to full size. And then just start plowing across like that. Be careful around the parts that you're trying to preserve. This might take a little bit of while, as you don't have a touch screen. But I cut off the boots. So what I'm going to do is Control Z. Oh, that didn't work. Oh, I see. Undo. Oh, took me pretty far back, but we'll be okay. There's the cat and the boots and the hat. Those are my three for this picture, right? Then you black out everything else. What are three interesting things that you can zoom in on in this picture? Take a moment to find three things that you're interested in this picture. Me, I like this first, this guy up here, and I gotta say, I like this little complex here. So let me go ahead and circle them. I gotta shrink it down first. Then I gotta circle it. There we are. I'm going to preserve that and this movie star. The rest has got to go. That's the assignment. There's my three images. Let's try it again with the school. Ooh. Like those trees. Oh. Undo. So I'm going to get this tree. I like the distinction between the tree and the bright brick, so I'm going to circle the bright brick. One thing else I notice is the doors have an interesting color blue, so I'm going to keep that front door. All right, now I switch over to a deeper size and get rid of the rest that's not circled. It's that easy and that satisfying, yo. And there we have it. Let's try it two more times, all right? Here we have a crowd. What are some interesting things with this crowd? Well, they're certainly a different color, right? So we've got this guy with the red hat. And we've got some plain Janes, right? This couple here and these friends here, right? Probably through no fault of their own for sure. And then you X out the rest. And those are my three images there. And then finally, I've got my images. What I'd like y'all to do is, I've rushed you a little bit on this last one for a reason, because I would like you to come up with your own three things to highlight in this last picture, please. So please take the time to do that now. Oh, yeah. All right. So now we've had a chance to boil pictures down to three different things that we notice. Now we're going to get a little more language specific. And I've blown up the words so they're a little easier to see. All right. This is the beginning. Little Yoshio wiggled with anticipation. 3, 2, 1. And he threw open the door, the front door. Anticipation seems important to me. Right? What did he do? He wiggled with it. So I'm going to connect wiggled and anticipation. Question, why is my dude counting down before he goes outside? And then finally, if we're focused on imagery, what's supposed to be so imagistic about it? Because all I can tell is it's the picture, the contrast between the stark tan and the vibrant blue outside. So I don't know if I see it. In the text itself, there is one word, front, maybe not the best connotation, but not too bad. We have some medium connotations between 1, 2, and 3, right? They don't intrinsically mean anything negative, right? And then through and wiggled kind of get those positive connotations. So when I read through it, little Yoshio wiggled, seems positive to me. With anticipation, seems positive. 3, 2, 1. Seems neutral. He threw open the front door. Front there doesn't seem too negative, but that's the only negative I got, right? You might also go with maybe little if he doesn't like being called little, but that's a stretch, right? Now what you want to do is you want to turn on that highlighter. And if it's positive, I want you to highlight it in purple. Any positive words you see, highlight the strongest connotations, blue, positive, and red, negative. Oh, let me switch to blue. So let me see if I see any positive. I see wiggled. I see anticipation. And I see open. And it says red are negative. The only kind of negative one I saw was front. So could I do a blackout poem that involves some of those words and others? Well, yeah, that's my assignment. So I'm going to switch over to pencil. I'm going to take it off super thick and put it on this level. And I'm going to come up with a poem right now. You can come up with the same poem that I do. Little Yoshio wiggled. Well, I'm going to keep little, but get rid of Yoshio. Get rid of the proper name. Little wiggled with anticipation. I'm going to get rid of with. Little wiggled anticipation. 3... Oop. I'm gonna get rid of 2. Show that they're in a rush. 3, 1. Through open the front door. I'm just gonna put through open door. Now I've got a whole new poem. Little wiggled anticipation. 3, 1. Through open door. And then on this other side here, I'm going to put a little picture to go with it. Obviously, I'll draw it on paper if I came unprepared to class today for whatever reason. I'm sure all legit. All right, so I'm going to get rid of these directions. I memorized them. I'm going to put a little picture that matches the poem over here. What will my picture be? Little wiggled anticipation threw open the door. 3, 1 threw open the door. Well, I'm going to put a big old stinking thing. .. 1 exclamation point. And then underneath it, I'm going to put the front door. And I'm going to put the fact that it's open. And that's it. You can make it more detailed later if you want. Let's try this one. Yoshio listened to the sound of his boots squishing and squashing through the puddles, and the tiny raindrops patterning on his umbrella. The sound of his giddy giggles made him giggle more. Well, I definitely noticed giddy, and giggles, and giggles, giggle rather, all have the bunch of cheese in them. So I see a pattern there. Is there anything that seems important that he's listening? Anything that seems connected with our prompt about imagery? Well, I like that patterning, right? The sound of patterning. This is a great page for writing that essay. So patterning seems good on the page by itself. Seems like it's in between. Tiny, not always the best connotation. Squashing, not always the best, but not always bad. And then giddy and giggles are so positive, you just can't get around it. Right? So if we find giddy and we find giggles, maybe we find umbrella as something that's neutral and puddles as negative, and a negative connotation might also go along with squishing. Not my favorite word. So now you've got to make another blackout poem. Well, first, we've got to highlight the strongest connotations in blue that are positive and red that are negative. So switch over to highlighter, switch over to blue, and I've got patterning. I'll keep as positive. Giddy, giggles, giggle. Oh, so how can I make this a blackout poem? I know. I'll get rid of a lot of it. Now let's try. Yoshido, tiny raindrops patterning on his umbrella. Let's get rid of the sound. Just leave sound. Now, Yoshido, tiny raindrops patterning on his umbrella. Sound, giddy, giggles, giggle. Ooh, I love that. Then I'll switch it over to white. Drag this up, and I'll do a little picture to go along with it. And you guys can do the same. My picture, it's just going to be someone laughing. Use a little text. Boom. Now there's two more. This next one we'll do together, but the last one, guess who's in charge of it? You are. So let's take a look at this. Yoshiro heard the creak of the school gates as he pulled them open. No one was at school yet. He put on his inside shoes and listened as they shuffled on the tiny floor. Me? I don't know what inside shoes are. What seems important is that he's supposed to be quiet, right? So he listened as they shuffled. He's paying attention to sound. And of course, if you're listening, you might be listening for a shuffling sound. All right. Does it have much to do with imagery? Ooh, shiny certainly does. So creek, not always positive. School, I love it. I'd give it a positive all day, but maybe a student might not. So I might put it on shiny and open to be safe. And I see yet, floor, and shuffle. For me, yet is that like main no connotation word. Yoshiro heard the creak of the school gates as he pulled them open. No one was at the school yet. He put on his inside shoes and listened as they shuffled on the shiny floor. I'm going to get shiny. I'm going to get shuffled. And then it seems in between is school. So how can I turn this into a poem? How can I turn this to a blackout poem? Well, first, I've got to highlight the strong connotations in blue and red. Right? Strong. Shiny. Shoes in between, listened in between, but he had to change them. So maybe I'll make the shoes red. And figure out what to do with the rest of the poem. Put on my pencil. Maybe not as thick. Perfect. School gates and pulled them open. No one was at school yet. Let's start there. No one was at school yet. he put on his inside shoes. Well, that seems redundant to me, so I'm going to get rid of he put on his inside shoes and just put inside shoes. Get rid of and. Inside shoes listened. Get rid of the as. They shuffled on the shiny floor. Ooh, that's my favorite one yet. Check out the picture I do with this one. I'm about to tear it up. First we erase that left side. Then we quickly dispatch it to the void. And then we write the poem that goes there. Right? Or we try to make a picture that goes with the poem that goes there. Me, I like the shiny floor. So I'm going to draw a little line here. I'm going to draw some disco dots here. And they will not show up because they're apparently better. And then finally, they shuffled on the floor. I'm going to give a little music to this one. So I'm going to go, oops, wrong one. Bring this one down. Give that a shoe too. Boom, music it is. This last part, you're going to take care of yourself. You're going to annotate it. You're going to find the connotations in it, isolated and in the paragraphs themselves, and then turn it into a poem. I know you can do it. I know you can get it. I believe in you. Now is the time. Go right ahead.